Right. You would never know that this morning when I woke up, I felt like I was done for. And complete train wreck. And then what did I do? I said, you know what? It's all in my mind. I have to change my mental outlook. And so I just asked the Holy Spirit, can you do that for me? Please do that for me today. And look what's happening. Tremendous. So it's not in our body, it's in our mind. The problem is in our mind. So welcome to the video. Now, in order to help in this world, help anyone, we have to speak in a way that seems upside down and backwards. Because why? Because the world itself, the way the world talks, is the normal way we talk is upside down and backwards entirely. So in order to talk, to point to truth, we have to speak in a truthful, more truthful way, which seems upside down and backwards, and people just say, wow, what in the world are you talking about? Now, when people ask questions, what are they really saying? Let's say you had come to someone who's enlightened and you ask them questions. What they're really asking is, I'm afraid if I'm enlightened, people are going to ask me this question. How am I going to answer this question? Right? How am I going to answer that question? And the answer to that is, well, come on over to where I am, and then see how to answer it from that perspective. People say, whoa, no, wait a minute. I'm not sure if you're going to have the answers. But the way that anyone, if someone asks, you say, well, come on over to my perspective. And they say, well, but what if someone asks me? Well, you tell them the same thing. That don't come on over and like that. So, like, for instance, Sri Nisargadatta, they have these questioners are questioning him, questioning. What do they want? They want words, actually. They want words. They want nice words. They want to hold, say, give me an explanation that I can give someone else. And he says, come on over to where I am. Just come on over. And then see what is it that needs to be explained. So people are not really very ambivalent, to say the least. Very ambivalent. They want to cover both sides. So here we're trying to speak in a way that is helpful. And it's not easy, not necessarily that easy in this culture. We don't have a culture of doing that, really. We don't. And yet we still have to do it, so there can be no excuse. Now, when we say drop the me, what is me? What is me? You ever ask the question, what is me? Me stands for more effort. It stands for more effort. When someone says, well, you know, what about you, is talking about me. You say, you mean me? He says, yeah, you know, don't you have to give more effort? When we look at each other, we're looking for more effort from each one another, right? Okay, more effort to do what? We all say, well, I have a me. We all have a me, which means we all have this agreement to give more effort. More effort for what? More effort for what? Well, here's where the rubber meets the road. More effort to fail. More effort to fail. People say, I want to be happy. Okay, now here's the twist. They want to fail at happiness and be happy over the fact that they have failed at happiness. This is the whimsicality of the world, and we don't seem to realize that this is impossible. We say, no, there's nothing impossible for us. I know that a lot of slogans, a lot of people like the slogan, nothing is impossible. You know, that's not true. One of the best teachings anyone can ever get, which I certainly got, I think it's just the best teaching from Jesus, was that we cannot change what we truly are. It's impossible. That's the one thing we can't do. We can imagine and experience everything, except we cannot change what we are. And wouldn't you know it, that's exactly what we're trying to do. He said, you know, God said, don't eat of the fruit of the fruit that's on the tree in the middle of the garden, meaning your essential true nature. You can't eat of that fruit. You can't change that fruit. You can eat of all the other fruits, but what we are, intrinsically are, we can't change that. Yeah, so of course we're trying to change it. And he said, if you eat of that fruit, you will surely die. Think that you're going to, you know, you're dying because you're trying to fail. When we try to change what we are, we're trying to get what we are to fail. We're trying to create failure. And of course we're not happy trying to make happiness fail, because we're all prototyping. Okay, this is how happiness can fail. Maybe this way is happiness fail. Maybe this death will make happiness fail. Maybe this sickness and death and aging will make happiness fail. Maybe this frustration, maybe this tiredness, maybe this body, maybe that body, maybe this war, maybe this struggle, the stress, maybe just hanging out and waiting will make happiness fail. And so of course we're quote unquote unhappy. We're not experiencing our happiness, intrinsic happiness. But we say, as soon as we make it fail, then we'll be happy. What'll be happy? If we make happiness fail, where's the happiness going to be? See, we haven't thought that one out yet. Well, we say magically, it's like a phoenix from the ashes of burnt, ruined happiness, arises a phoenix, we think, of even of ultimate happiness. So we think that reality, we say, oh yeah, the reality is perfect, it's how we're happy, it's great, but we're working on ultimate reality, something even beyond that, where reality actually fails, and out of that failure arises a phoenix of rebirth of an ultimate reality, even beyond reality. No such situation. But that is what we're working on. So of course we want to succeed at failure, thinking that's our happiness. It's not. But this is the peculiar situation that anyone who's trying to help here runs into, and causes a great deal of consternation, and actually causes most of us to fail here, because that's what this world's all about, is failure. So if you want to help, people say, great, be a better failure then. See, more effort towards failure. Embrace the me, embrace the more effort. Now, what does truth really need? Does truth need time to be what it is? Does happiness need time to be what it is? Does being need time to be what it is? What do we need time for? Failure. Each moment we're trying to make reality fail, and each moment it doesn't work. It doesn't work. And we keep feeling like we're such a failure. We can't succeed at failure. What's the matter with me? I'm unhappy. I'm unhappy. I'm unhappy. Every moment I'm unhappy. I failed again. I failed again. So we're aiming at a success. We're trying to succeed at failure. So paradoxically, if you want to be happy, stop trying to succeed. Stop trying to try. Stop the more effort. Don't give any more effort. What kind of effort does truth need to be true? Does truth need an effort on our part in order to be true? Does truth need an effort on our part to maintain its truth? Does everywhereness need an effort on our part for us to be there? Now, do we need to go somewhere to be everywhere? To be within everywhereness? There's some place we have to go first. See, I gotta go there, and then I'll be there. Okay. Is there any place in everywhereness? Is there a place, actually? Or are we all already there? Actually, there is no place. This is very key. I remember that the delusional part of what... The whole thing got me, of course. The whole complex got me. I was very resistant to it, but it got me. And I recall that the whole notion of places was silly. There's no such thing as a place. This world is not a place. It's not a world. It's not a place. There is no such thing as a place. There's no place in everywhereness. There's only everywhereness. Equally everywhere. There are no places. Say, I need to go somewhere. I need to go to this place. Yeah, if I go to this place, what? We think there's somewhere to go. Because first I need to go somewhere. That's more effort. I need to think something. Can we Does truth need our thinking to be true? I need to think about it. I need to think about it. Let me think about it. Because that takes time. I need to go somewhere. That takes time, right? So what we're saying is that I need some time in order for everywhere to be everywhere. I need to go to this place. There is no place. From that perspective, from a mundane, practical, as far as the body is, we can say this place, but we're talking about truth and spirit and what we are. We're not in a place. Nobody's in a place. There's not a superior place. There's not an inferior place. There is no place. There's no place at all. There's only everywhereness. It's very, very important. Because I do recall the whole notion of, I remember my happiness was because of not thinking that I was anywhere. I was everywhere. In other words, I was in the everywhereness. And then people said, no, you're in a body, you're in this body's in a place. What's a body but thinking about a place? This body, this is your house, this is your place, this is your place, you're not somewhere else. And then the happiness, disappeared. Because they say, well, you need to apply more effort for happiness. Happiness comes from effort, from time. No, failure is what we hope to come upon from time, from effort. What else can we do? Trying to create failure, then give it time and effort and place and persons and all that. It's all to no avail, but what else can we do with it? We have to experience it this way, as time and effort, more effort in time. So we need to drop effort, drop trying, drop success. The whole idea of success implies time, right? Because it implies you're not successful now. So there's a next moment where we say, well, we will be successful, but in the future, that means time. Same with going somewhere, that implies time. Now we may say, wow, this is just talk, I wanted to talk about nothing. Actually, it's talk about the very heart of the situation. The more effort, dropping any more effort. We don't need effort to be where we already are, which is everywhere, in the everywhereness. Everything is already there. We don't need to rearrange anything. We don't need to say, whoa, there's somebody over there. I better go help them because they're not in the right place. No, everyone's in the right place. Everything's in the right place. Everyone's in the right time. Right now. Everyone's in the right place right now. Everyone's in the right time frame right now. Everyone's in the right mind state right now. Everyone has the right thoughts right now. And this is the perfection. This is the actual perfection of right now. Everyone's in their home right now. Everyone's in the one home. So this is the necessary way of turning it, the backwards upside downness, turning it right side up. I am happiness. I am happiness. It's not that I got happiness. I don't have got. I am happiness. There's only happiness, so I must be it. I am happiness. I didn't find it. I didn't get it. I am it. I use the phrase, I am Hawaii. I don't need to go to Hawaii. I don't have to go. I am Hawaii. See, I am Hawaii. It's not out there. Hawaii is a state of mind. I am the state of mind. I am Hawaii. I am that beautiful, blissful, softly swaying breeze, you know, just the ambience. That I am that. I am the happiness, so to speak. If you use Hawaii of a like idyllic, you know, state of mind, right? An idyllic state of mind. Why do we go to Hawaii? To experience an idyllic state of mind, of course. But we need to see how it really is and say, I am Hawaii. I am Hawaii. Now, so all of this, I'm sure that most of you are following, you know, you're saying, yeah, okay. Okay, what's the catch? Continuity problem is the catch. No matter how well we understand this, we don't actually experience it. Why? Time. We want to give a little time. We're used to failure, right? So we say, let's give this a little time to fail. Let's give this a little time to fail. Now, I was in the transcendent state two nights ago. Personal perspective had dropped away, and I was just watching it, and then I saw visually this like two-pronged like skewer coming towards me, and it poked me in the side, and suddenly I felt deflated, and I went back into the personal state. I said, okay, I see that. What is that? What is that? It's duality. Well, what does it mean? It's time. A two-pronged fork of time, meaning now and then later. Gap between cause and effect. It was so time poked me in the side, and I deflated back into personal perspective, into delusion, into unhappiness, and into the attempt to fail. So we can understand all this, but how do we get past that? How do we, you know, how's the continuity problem? How do we get past that continuity issue where we say, well, wait a minute, I want the ultimate success. Say, I got happiness, but what about the ultimate happiness? What does ultimate imply? Does it not imply time? It means that you've reached the end of what? Of time? If there is no time, how can we reach the end of time? So whatever we get, then we'll say, okay, that's great, but what about the ultimate? The ultimate. This is not one moment in time. It's timeless. Truth is timeless. It's not a moment in time. The holy instant is not really a moment in time. It's a moment free of time. So, we have to practice. As unglamorous as that is, we have to practice. And that's, again, another spot where the rubber meets the road. Because our addiction to failure hates practicing because we're not giving enough time to think. We're saying, no, I am Hawaii. I am Hawaii. I am Hawaii. And the ego saying, whoa, wait a minute, what do you mean? What do you mean? What do you mean by I'm Hawaii? Whoa, what do you mean? Meaning, let's give it some time and let's talk about it. Let's give that some time now. To what? Truth needs time for what? To fail. So what the ego's really saying is, whoa, let's give that little time to fail. So that's great, but let's let it fail. And once it fails, we'll have something even better. That's what happens. So practicing what we do in any practice is we gather our will together, determination, say, I'm going to do this, and we just do it. And we do it for as long as we can until the wheels start coming off and the ego's desperate attempts to pull us back into time. Gradually, you know, we succumb to that. Do not try and answer any questions when you're practicing. When you're practicing, you are not trying to answer any questions or entertain any questions. that you're not going to answer him, but don't even entertain him. Just say, I am Hawaii. And nothing else is Hawaii. I am Hawaii and nothing else is Hawaii. I am Hawaii and nothing else is Hawaii. Right here, right now, always and forever, I am Hawaii. That's what I am. I am Hawaii. There is no other Hawaii. I am Hawaii. I am Hawaii. There is no other Hawaii. I am Hawaii. I am the one and only Hawaii. I'm it. I am Hawaii. I am Hawaii. I am Hawaii. Okay, so there's an example of that. Now we may try to look at the results. Okay, now what? How effective was that? What do I want to do? What to do? Don't do that. Don't do that. Don't do that. Don't look to measure any results of anything. What is measurement of time? I'm Hawaii right now. I'm Hawaii right now. There's no measurement of time involved. So this is the key, is we're talking about what is already the case. And there's no measurement involved in how long did it take to be the case. It's already the case. And you say, well, how long did it take us to know? There is no us. I am Hawaii. The me means more effort. Now, we may say, okay, well, is it working? Is it working? What, are we giving up effort? Are we letting go of effort by saying, I'm already what I want? See, we want that Hawaii state of mind, that idyllic state of mind, and we're just saying, I'm already that. I'm already that. I am that. Already. I already am that. This is the whole gist of practice, is to acknowledge that I'm already that, so that I don't need any effort to be what I am. But paradoxically, we need to make a great effort to realize we don't need to make any effort, to get used to the fact, to accept it. Because remember, the entirety of existence is more effort. The idea we need to pour more effort to get to where we want to go. And what we're saying is we already are where we want to go. We've never left where we want to go. We're in the everywhereness. We're in Hawaii already. And we are Hawaii already. This is Hawaii. This is Hawaii. I am Hawaii. This is Hawaii. There's only Hawaii. How could I not be in Hawaii? There's only Hawaii. There's only an idyllic state of mind. There is no other state of mind. Everything else is just a dream, which isn't really a state of mind at all. It's an attempt to fail. It's an attempt to failure. So I am Hawaii. This is Hawaii. I am Hawaii. This is the Hawaii. There's only Hawaii. So where do I need to go? What do I need to think? What effort do I need to make? So this is the practice that enables it to dawn upon us. And what happens, time comes in and deflates it. Okay, but being aware of that and seeing it is a huge step. And the capacity for me, I was able to see how time came in and skewered me in the side, as it were, and deflated me out. I just noticed, I said, okay, all right, I see that. Just seeing that is hugely important. So when you when any of us are in, we've managed there to let go, relax our mind, release our thoughts and let them go to some extent, release our valuing through our practicing and through discourse, you may have some peak moments for sure. And just be aware. Say, express your gratitude and your appreciation. This is wonderful, it's wonderful. Be aware, and then you will notice. Whatever you notice is important. You just notice. And when you come out of it, say, okay, well, why did I come out of that? Why did I come out of that? More effort. Okay? More effort. The habit of more effort. Now we say, well, okay, I'm just going to try real hard not to have any effort. No, that's more effort too. So, because we are so habituated to more efforts, in other words, it's never enough. More effort is our whole quote-unquote identity. The me, is actually more effort. And we believe more effort is our identity, actually. Just simply out of squatter's rights, so to speak, where we've been doing it for so long, we just, you know, assume. It's like someone squatter in your house. Somebody left for a vacation for a while, long time, to come back, and someone's been living in their house the whole time. And they come back and they say, hey, what are you doing? And they said, hey, what are you doing? He says, I live here. He said, I live here. You know, and he said, well, I've been living here for, you know, 6 months here. You haven't been here. And they try to say, well, we own the place because we've been living here. So we make more effort. We think more effort is our identity. So almost automatically, we go back and say, okay, that was nice, the impersonal viewpoint that is not tied to any person is wonderful, but okay, now I need to make more effort, and then poof, away it goes, like that, back in dreamland. And the question is, well, which is dreaming? Is the personal perspective dreaming, or is the God perspective dreaming? Is the personal perspective that's a dream? But we're not sure of that yet. Time is the dream. And we think that something good will not just be sustained unless we give it more effort. We say, okay, how do I sustain this? I need more effort. No. Then we go into time. All right. Various commotions going on, but that's life. And so you just have to keep practicing. I am Hawaii. I am Hawaii. I am Hawaii. I am. Meaning, another commotion. All right, back again. Many commotions. It's I am Hawaii. Okay, I am Hawaii. The ego says, what do you mean you can't be Hawaii? I am Hawaii. You mean you want to go to Hawaii? I am Hawaii. I am Hawaii. I am Hawaii. You may reach a point where it's sunk in, and then you can just be there like empty mind, as it were. I am Hawaii. Because the ego doesn't have any more questions for you. You run out of questions, you keep doing it, and the questions drop away. I am Hawaii, then everywhere is, right? Wherever I am, it is Hawaii. Because I always am. I am Hawaii. I am everywhere. What's the idyllic state of mind? Everywhereness. I am everywhereness. The effort to leave it is nothing. The effort to leaving is not a question. It's just nothing. The question, how do I leave everywhereness? I need more effort to answer that question. It's an unanswerable question. It's not even a question. There isn't any way to leave everywhereness. So it's not even a question. So we don't need to answer it. We don't need more effort to try and answer that question. So we let go of the effort to answer the unanswerable non-question. That can never even be asked. Of who? Of what? Asking everywhere? Where is it? Is there somewhere else everywhere? No, everywhere is everywhere. So to bring it down to this world, I am Hawaii, so to speak. I always want a Hawaiian vacation, you know, but the Holy Spirit hasn't given it to me. Saying, you are Hawaii, I am Hawaii. Just say, I am Hawaii. Your vacation is to be as you are, is to be what you are, which is everywhere. We're already in everywhere land, Hawaii land. We're already in Hawaii. In fact, we are Hawaii. We literally are Hawaii. We are everywhereness. That is what we are. That is what everything is. Everything is everywhereness. Everything is everywhereness. Everything is everywhereness. Everything is everywhereness. I am Hawaii. I am Hawaii. Now the structure of thought is all reverberating. You see, we have a structure of thought which we think is our identity of more effort. And this structure of thought is always trying to add and remodel and reinforce itself. When you say, I am Hawaii, when you say this, the whole structure of thought, it shakes, as it were. It reverberates through the structure of thought. And of course, nothing has to be changed or rearranged with any thoughts whatsoever, because I am Hawaii. This is not in thought. This is mind. That mind is Hawaii. Spirit is Hawaii. God is Hawaii. Everything is Hawaii. Everything is Hawaii. So, without trying to isolate any thought or structure or anything, you simply keep saying this, I am Hawaii, everything is Hawaii. And it's not brought up to your intellect to work on. Not working on anything. You don't need to work anything. I already am Hawaii. Nothing to work on. Everything as it is Hawaii. I am Hawaii. And eventually we'll decide, well, I don't want to try to leave what I am. I don't want to leave Hawaii. I don't really want to leave Hawaii. I, as I am Hawaii. I am, as I am, Hawaii. Everything, as it is Hawaii. So why do we want to leave that? To try and make it fail. Try to fail to be in Hawaii, to be somewhere else. Why do we want to do that? So we can be greater than God. compete with God? Why do we want to compete with God? Ask this question, why do we want to compete with God? Is it for the fun of it? For the fun of it. Well, is it fun? So I am Hawaii. I am Hawaii. I am as I am Hawaii. Everything is as it is Hawaii. This is Hawaii time. This is Hawaii time. The timeless is Hawaii time. This is Hawaii time. I am Hawaii. Now, as we do this, for me at least, no thoughts or very few thoughts are rising. It's almost like a blank mind. I am Hawaii. There's nothing that needs to be said, right? I am Hawaii. Everything is Hawaii. All time is Hawaii time. This now is Hawaii time. This moment is Hawaii time. To be metaphoric about it. And no real thoughts are arising. So, well, we can get used to no thoughts arising. Do we need a thought arising? That thought too is in Hawaii. So why do we need to be concerned or pay attention? Everything's in Hawaii, so whatever thought arises doesn't matter. Doesn't change anything. Doesn't add anything. Doesn't subtract anything. We get used to the thoughtless state. A state that has no thought arising. We don't need to make any effort to be what we are, only to fail to be what we are. That's where the effort, that's where the thought, the strategy comes in. We don't need any of that. We don't need a strategy to be where we already are. I am Hawaii. I am Hawaii. So, this is an introduction to this. I am Hawaii. Very, very important. I am that perfect place. I am that perfect place. Not I am there, I am the perfect place. There's no there in reality. Reality is not a there-ness. It's a isness. It's a beingness. There's no there and everywhere. I'm always home. I am the idyllic state. I am in the idyllic place. I am Hawaii. I am actually that. I am that. no effort is needed to be that. It's effortless. All effort is effort to fail. All effort is effort to fail. Except working on the continuity problem. Because we're so addicted to effort that we cannot simply drop effort immediately, directly. We feel it's too much of a severe continuity issue for us. So how do we use effort in a way that doesn't take us further into delusion? And it's by this practice. I am Hawaii. I am Hawaii. Just remind ourselves where we are. We haven't really forgotten, but we've tried to forget. So we need to try to remember. You see what I'm saying? This is the heart of it. We've tried so hard to forget what we are. We can't drop the trying. So we have to try at something. So we have to try and remember, as it were, even though we haven't really forgotten. See, this is where the intellect struggles, but it doesn't need to. It's a very simple explanation. We have tried so hard to forget that trying really hard is, we believe it is essential to our identity. In fact, we believe it is our identity. Now, what we know is it's really not, but in order to let go of what we think is our identity, in order to experience what really is our identity, we need to sort of set it down gently. Therefore, we do have to try hard. For a while. And we try hard to accept that we don't need to try hard. So I am Hawaii. I am Hawaii. Now we think there should be some shortcut. There really isn't. There really isn't a shortcut. Except to drop all trying. But again, we're so addicted, we believe our identity is trying, so we're not willing to drop it. So we can get trapped into some concept of dropping it. Okay, which some may have got trapped in that. Possible, right? Possible. It's better to try. Well, at least go through the motions of trying. See, I am Hawaii, full stop. I am Hawaii, full stop. What we're doing is we're getting used to barely trying, right? You just think, I am Hawaii, full stop. And then say, I am Hawaii, full stop. So over and over again, we get used to barely trying. We're barely trying. Just get used to barely trying, but get used to it a lot. So we repeat it over and over and over. I am Hawaii, full stop. I am Hawaii, full stop. I am Hawaii, full stop. So we repeat over and over and over until we get comfortable with barely trying. And then from there, we can gently set down trying altogether. We're not trying to form a concept of not trying, okay? We're not trying to form any concept of not trying. We are simply becoming adept at barely trying as the intermediate step, a soft landing into the vision of oneness, into realization. I am Hawaii. Everything is Hawaii. There's only Hawaii. There's only Hawaii. Hawaii is all there is. I am Hawaii. So in this barely trying, we don't struggle. We don't struggle. Full stop. I am Hawaii. Full stop. Quiet mind. Not thinking, not trying not to think. We're just using our attention and our will and our determination and our desire and compassion and grace to say, I am Hawaii. I am Hawaii. I am Hawaii. Full stop. So what is important in any practice is you make that full stop. You say the statement and that's a full stop. There's nothing to add to it. You're not adding to it. You're not subtracting to it. You're not questioning it. You're not demanding anything of the other statement whatsoever. You're just making the statement, I am Hawaii, as a self-evident truth. We're simply stating self-evident truth out of the habit of trying. Of course, self-evident truth, you don't have to try at all. It's self-evident. But again, the continuity problem of ferociously trying so hard for so long, we think it's our identity, so we now barely try. All right, that's it.